Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We pray. Father, help us to find our certainty in you and not in ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. So the gospel today is all about a wedding. And since Hope and I were married just a little bit under 2 years ago, I still can remember a lot of the emotions that I felt at this wedding. I remember one moment in particular where the joy that I felt and the emotions, the excitement that I felt was just so overwhelming that I lost control of my face, my body, and my tear ducts all at the same time. Now, I wanted to keep some composure. I'm a man after all. And so, despite wanting to jump and dance for joy, my face ended up something a little bit like this. And the catalyst, of course, for this feeling of emotion was my beautiful bride walking down the aisle toward me. Now, a wedding is not only a joyful experience for the bride and the groom. And yes, you have the ceremony that has a new life situation for these two, but there's also the wonderful joy of the banquet with only the tastiest of food. There's that art form that we call dancing that usually takes place. And what would a wedding be without a decadent dessert? And so in its truest sense, a wedding is a joyful situation. And this is what I want to keep in mind today when we hear the parable and we hear Jesus say that the kingdom of heaven is like a king planning a wedding banquet for his son. Now, a king is most likely the richest man in the whole kingdom. So you would be a fool to refuse a request to the wedding of a lifetime. It's certainly to have the best of food and the best of entertainment and the best of decorations. And as well, the king is certainly the most powerful man in the whole kingdom. And so if you were to refuse the request to come to this wedding, what might be the last decision that you make? And it refuses exactly what some people did when they received the invitation. Now, the king was patient and forgiving, and so he sweetened the deal. He sent out messengers to say, look, I've slaughtered my ox and my fat calf. As if to say, hey, if you attend this wedding, you're going to have ribeyes and prime rib and filet mignon. It's going to be a good wedding. Steak so tender and juicy that with the first bite, it's life-changing. And yet still, they refused. In fact, when the messengers came with this good news, some they ignored and others they killed. Well, the king was not happy, so he sends in his army and destroys their city. He says, what are we to do? The wedding banquet is ready. So he does something a little crazy. He pulls people off the streets, anyone you find, the bad as well as the good, because this wedding banquet must be filled. And then something kind of odd happens. The whole banquet hall is filled with people, and the king comes in, and he sees one individual who's not wearing the proper wedding garment. He says, how did you get in here, friend? And the man is speechless. And the king says, throw him out into the darkness where there's wailing and gnashing of teeth. Now, I know the first time that I heard this parable when I was young, I remember reading that and thinking, where does that come from? I mean, just think about it. You're pulling people off the streets. There's a good chance that some of them might be homeless, or they might be so poor that they can only afford the one tunic. How is that a reasonable expectation that they should have a wedding garment to be able to wear to this wedding? But, as I've now read, I come to know that the custom of Jesus' day was that the host of a wedding, in addition to the invitation, would also provide wedding garments to those who were invited. And so to receive this garment and then decide to show up to the wedding without it is about the same as walking up to the host, slapping him in the face, and then sitting down expecting to be able to stay at the banquet. Now, I remember when I was younger, my understanding of this parable, well, when you hear the kingdom of heaven, I immediately thought of that place that we profess that we're going to go to when we die someday because we believe in Jesus. And so following this line of progression, you have heaven, which is a wonderful place. It's like a wedding banquet. And there are some people who, even though they're invited, they're going to refuse to go. And then I honestly skipped most of the middle mentally, and then jumped to the end where there's darkness and wailing and gnashing of teeth. And I'm like, oh yeah, that sounds like hell. And so to summarize, it was, you know, you got heaven, it's a wonderful place, you want to go there, some people don't. And my hope today is that you do not walk away with that understanding of this parable, because I do not believe that is what Jesus is saying. See, understanding this parable to me hinges on what Jesus means when he says the kingdom of heaven. And I believe that most of the time when he speaks about the kingdom of heaven, he is in fact talking about the rule and reign of God. And so, when he says the kingdom of heaven, the rule and reign of God, is like a wedding banquet, the rule and reign of God is a joyous thing to be a part of. And yet some people, the Israelites who were first invited to be a part of it, they said, we don't want that. We reject being a part of this kingdom. And God even sweetens the deal a little bit. He sends prophets to say, hey, these are the splendors of following God, of being under his authority. And yet they rejected the prophets, just like the messengers going to tell the good news of the ox and the leopard calf. And so they ignore some, they beat others, and they kill others. And so God destroys their city. And in 70 AD, the Romans come through and destroy Jerusalem, which they had put their trust in for how they were in a right relationship with God. But God is saying, this is not the way. And so in the parable, people off the streets, the bad as well as the good, are invited. But along with that invitation was the wedding garment, the robe of righteousness that Christ earned for us through his death and resurrection. Now there are some people, though, who wanted to come to the party, wanted to be part of the rule and reign of God, but in an inappropriate manner. You see, they didn't want to wear the robe of righteousness that Christ earned for them. No, they wanted to come in by their own righteousness. And this isn't just true for the Pharisees of Jesus' day. In fact, in the parable, this actually is described and comes after the Gentiles have been invited to the rule and reign of God. And we, who are Gentiles, should know that we are not immune from this line of thinking either. See, it's quite possible for us to look at everything that we do in church, or look at how well we follow the Ten Commandments, or even look at how well we boldly profess Christ in the world, and we look to those things for our certainty that we're a part of the kingdom. And the parable says what happens to individuals who look to their own righteousness. It says they'll be thrown out into the darkness where there is wailing and gnashing of teeth. The man who was wearing the improper garments was speechless, but I imagine he was thinking, what do you mean I'm not wearing the right clothes? Because he was looking to his own righteousness. And darkness is spoken about, actually, in the book of Isaiah. It says, the people walking in darkness have seen a ray of light. And in John 1, it says, the light shined in the darkness, but the darkness did not overcome it. You see, this darkness is the world apart from the rule and reign of God. And in this place, there is no true hope. You cannot hope and trust in your own righteousness, and at the same time, hope and trust in Christ's righteousness. And so when you have no true hope and sorrows come, there is wailing, for you have nothing to hope for. And when someone wrongs you, there's gnashing of teeth, which is anger, because you don't have God to put your hope in the darkness. But I want to focus once more on this robe. I think this cartoon is an apt depiction of what's going on here. You see in the upper right, the robes of righteousness tailored, and the man in the white suit with righteousness on his side. On the sign says, special today, trading your old rags for a new suit, free, all costs paid by the owner. And on the bottom right, it says, he's depositing the old garment of sin into God's grace. Below it says, I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God. For he has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of righteousness. You see, you have been invited to the wedding of the Lamb, the rule and reign of God. And all that is necessary for your participation in this wonderful reality is provided with you, provided for you along with the invitation. And that is the righteousness that comes from Christ, who died for you and rose again. This is done and offered to you so that you may have life abundantly. So do not put your trust in yourselves, but instead, put all your confidence in Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior. Amen. We stand and confess together.